Etepu, assalamu alaikum, namaste, Harun Nefer. This is Kisank Mai Keparu with another exciting video for you. And in this video, we're going to be talking about the Good Times reboot, the cartoon animation that has just recently been released. We're going to talk about that, released by Netflix. But before I get into that, I want you to hit the like button on this video. That's very important. Hit the like button. And if this is your first time to my channel, hit the subscribe button to get notifications on when I go live and when I upload recorded videos. If you'd like to know more about my spiritual teachings, you can scroll down below and click on any one of the four ebook links. You can download those ebooks today and start reading. They're absolutely free. But if that's not enough for you, you can become a Patreon supporter for as little as $1, $5, or $20 per month. There's no obligation. You can quit at any time. You'll get exclusive access to instructional videos, videos on the spiritual, videos on the esoteric, videos that will teach you how to do lucid dreaming, how to do astral projection, how to put together a magical amulet for your protection, how to contact the ancestors, how to do proper breathing exercises, how to do meditations, and so much more. So become a Patreon supporter today. Last but not least, share this video with family and friends so we can get the revolution started. So, Harun Nefer, namaste. Grand Rising, how are you today? I'm doing extremely well today. And I want to get into this whole new thing that's being released by Netflix, the Good Times cartoon animation. So, many of you, I hope you remember that show with JJ. You know, he would go, "Dynamite!" You know? And you had Thelma, you had Michael the Revolutionary, you know. This was a show I did not like to watch as a kid. And it kind of like reinforced the idea of Blacks impoverished, Blacks in poverty. And it also reinforced certain stereotypes. You know, JJ was always goofy, you know, in a way. But, you know, what came out of that were really good shows like Living Single, Another World, The Cosbys, which did show a more upper class, affluent Black family. But for a time there with Good Times, I couldn't stand to watch it because it was just like, I know Blacks live in poverty because I can see it all around me. I don't need a TV show to remind me of that fact. Not that the TV show was wrong to do that. It's just there wasn't any like balanced representation at the time. If we had also saw something very similar to Cosby Show, then it wouldn't have bothered me so much. But the only things out there were kind of like the Jeffersons and, you know, and that also too, and Sanford and Son, but and that also too kind of played into certain stereotypes. But the Good Times, I felt, really took things a bit too far, because I personally would like to have seen them come out of the projects in Chicago. But anyway, so we have these producers who come along and thought it was a good idea to reimagine this as a cartoon animation. Bad idea. Bad idea. But not only that, but they decided to play up the stereotypes, and they got Netflix to buy into it because they had Seth MacFarlane backing this. And shame on you, Seth. This reimagined Good Times is one of the most awful, awful things I've seen in a long time. It is horrendous. And for Seth to do this specifically, there's a young baby, well, it's a baby, who's part of the family, the Evans family, who's a drug dealer. And I'm like, come on, Seth, how could you do this? Because, you know, Seth likes to put babies in his shows, you know. Stewie, you know, one of his nice characters, you know. And I'm going to let you in on a little secret, okay? This thing about, if you look at these shows, such as The Simpsons, you know, well, maybe not so much The Simpsons, you know, but Family Guy and the other shows, you will notice that the young characters verge on the LGBTQ lifestyle. This is not coming from the showrunner or you know, just the script writers alone. This is coming down from very high sources that say this has to be the case. Seth MacFarlane's, his new show, you know, which is kind of like very, very, The Ovals, I think it's called The Ovals, similar to Star Trek, has a black man who plays like a Klingon almost. It's not original, but he's gay. So these portrayals, especially when it comes to the baby, Stewie, being gay, which is what he is, they don't want to talk about it, come from high up top. You know, they're the ones that tell them exactly this is what you have to have. I mean, you have some freedom within parameters, so Seth can do certain things, but there are certain other things that the studio is not amendable to, and they will push back on. And they want a gay baby because they're trying to condition the minds of the youth out there to the acceptance of this lifestyle. So when you see this whole idea of being reproduced of, I guess he's supposed to be Michael, or the drug dealing baby, this is coming from higher up, because it's insane that you would attack the portrayal of a young child by making him a drug dealer. No community would sit by and allow this, but I digress. If you're not familiar with the show Good Times, let me take you down memory lane, and let me see if I can just play this and see if you guys get this.
From Television City in Hollywood.
Good time, you need a payment.
Good time,
you need a free.
Good time,
in a time you're out from under.
Not getting hassled, not getting hustled. Keeping your head up on water. Making a way when you can.
Temporary layoffs.
Good time,
easy credit rip-offs.
Good time.
Scratching and surviving.
Good time.
Hanging in a jar.
Good time.
Ain't we lucky we got them?
Good time.
I don't even want to go into what the song is trying to communicate. I don't want to even go into that. But that's the original. That's the opening to the original sitcom TV show back in the day, Good Times. So let me read this review of the reboot by Variety, and this is by the author of the article. Hold on a second. His name is Ahmad Timbu. Hope I pronounced that correctly. Forgive me if I didn't. All right. Oh, wait. We can listen to this article instead of read it. Let me see if that works. I was going to read it, but let's see.
Netflix's Good Times reboot is dated. Humorless and baffling TV review by Ahmad Timbu. 50 years ago, Good Times became the first sitcom to depict a two-parent Black American family. Now Netflix is debuting a present-day animated reboot chronicling the Evanses two generations after the original. Set in Chicago's Cabrini-Green projects in the same apartment from the 1970s dramedy, the series follows Reggie J.B. Smoove, his wife Beverly, Yvette Nicole Brown, and their children, Junior J. Farrow Gray, Masai Martin, and Dalvin Slink Johnson. Black people aren't a monolith, and respectability politics certainly aren't the answer to racism, sexism, bigotry, and homophobia. Yet it's puzzling that this mind-numbing series is how creator Renata Shepherd is paying homage to such a classic show while trying to speak to 21st century Black people. It's also very clear why Netflix decided against sending out screeners for review. In the season opener, Meet the Evans of New, we learn about the new occupants of Apartment 17C. Reggie, the grandson of Florida Esterol and James John Amos, is a struggling cab driver with hypertension and a penchant for long, drawn-out rants. Beverly is appearance-obsessed despite her family's financial struggles. Junior, the eldest, is an artist repeating 10th grade for the third time. Gray is whip-smart and activist-minded even to her detriment. Finally, Dalvin is a drug-dealing infant whom Reggie has thrown out of the house. The character was likely created to mirror Stewie from Family Guy. Seth MacFarlane is an executive producer on Good Times. Yet casting him as an infant drug dealer who sells crack on the street corners is neither amusing nor edgy. The first three episodes of Good Times, which is when I stopped watching, are stuffed full of repetitive stereotypes, stale jokes, and bizarre choices. The Evans apartment is roach-infested and dilapidated. Meanwhile, most characters, including Bev's best friend Lisa, Rashida Sheed's Olayiwola, who owns a beauty shop slash funeral parlor combo, appear to be caricatures of black people found in memes. Cabrini Green, the infamous high-rise project where this story is set, is also a wild choice, since it was demolished in 2011. If you're going to spotlight Chicago, it should be done with honesty and reverence to those who call it home. Good Times' perspective on the Windy City is not only narrowed and bullet-riddled, but it's seemingly born out of a skewed gangster rap version of the city. Still, there are a handful of interesting components here. When Beth prays, a video game playing Black Jesus appears, responding to or ignoring her pleas. This visualization is a direct callback to Florida from the original series Calling Out to God. In episode 2, Black of Focus, viewers are offered an inside-out visual into Junior's mind, which directly unpacks his academic failures and artistic talent. However, episode 3, Grey's Anatomy, offers the most compelling storyline. It chronicles Gray navigating her first period as everyone, including the school nurse and Bev, tries to shame her about menstruation. In a The Wiz-like sequence, this chapter addresses the hypersexualization of black girls as fast and womanly while taking direct shots at the end of Roe v. Wade through a Trump-type character, Brady Oscar Piles, aka GOP. Despite these few highlights, Good Times is overrun with issues. Some of these have already spilled into the public. The original creator, Carl Jones, wrote on Twitter slash X that he left the project during development due to creative differences. Moreover, that Nicole Brown, who voices Beverly in the series, is being attacked on the social media platform for just being a part of the show. The late Norman Lear, Bernadette Stanis, and Jimmy Walker, who played Thelma and JJ, respectively, in the original series, have minor roles. Stanis has spoken publicly about watching the new show's trailer. "I did a little voice for them, but I did not know it was going to be the way it is. I thought it was going to be different," she told a Hollywood reporter. She continued, "It's just a little here and there. But I think that they did that because they knew what their show was going to be like. So I guess they figured, if you put us in there, it wouldn't look so bad or whatever." Black creators and talent have vast experiences across political, social, and economic backgrounds. Like our white counterparts, we can express our experiences as we see fit. Yet amid the recent shuttering of numerous Black-led shows, including Rap Shit, Southside, and The Wonder Years, just to name a few, it's pathetic Hollywood is championing depictions that reduce Black people, racism, and systemic issues into one-dimensional minstrels lacking present-day relevance. What's worse is that the writing in Good Times just isn't funny. The remaining 7 of the 10-episode season likely won't be transformative or strike a different tone than the first 3. For one, the series fails to infuse humor and wit into everyday hardships, which has been done masterfully in shows including The Boondocks, The PJs, or even the 1970s Good Times. Moreover, the reboot has an antiquated feel, as if someone wrote the scripts decades ago and unearthed them in the present, barely adding tweaks or updates. The themes addressed, including money woes and Junior's undiagnosed ADHD, have been highlighted in copious Black-led shows throughout time. Sitcoms like Everybody Hates Chris, Black-ish, and The Cosby Show discussed these subjects with a brilliance that fails to materialize here. Reimagining Good Times for a 21st century audience could have been done brilliantly. Animation allows for a wealth of creative freedom, enabling viewers to see characters and their experiences in ways that live action doesn't. While the series' predecessor captivated viewers some 5 decades ago, these modern-day Evans are stuck in the past, unable or unwilling to connect with new generations who are still navigating so much and have so much to say. All 10 episodes of Good Times are streaming on Netflix. Next article.
Okay, so
my traumatizing years.
Let's get out of this. All right, let's get out of this. So it's very interesting how, you know, it talks about that this rendition is antiquated. It's not funny. It plays into stereotypes. So, and people in general, Black people in general, are outraged by this. And I applaud that. You should be outraged by this. But let me just bring up a point here that we have to keep in mind. It still seems that we have a very tempered or measured response to this. We should be looking to shut Netflix down for doing this and to shut Seth MacFarlane down as well in his shows. Because you couldn't do this with any other communities. See, this whole structure of the media controlled by white supremacy knows who to pick on. You see, they know that Black people are down and out, and they know that they can kick us when we're down. But here's the real problem that we have in the Black community. You see, we have nurtured and supported these images. Gangster, rap, thug, hustler, over-sexualized Black woman. Now, we didn't create these images because these images are inevitably shown through the lens of white supremacy. They're the ones responsible for putting out these images. But we support these images. See, they've already done, you know, like think tank institutions like the Rockefeller Foundation, the Council on Foreign Relations, you know, they've already done studies of Black people. And one thing they know about Black people is that we like name brand products. We believe what we see is real in mainstream media. We co-opt and copy what we see in mainstream media. So they know, the powers that be know how we act and how we think. And unfortunately, instead of looking at our communities and looking for these individuals who mirror these images, thug, hustler, b-boy, whatever, we seek to emulate them. And then white supremacy comes along and takes it to the next level and further enhances those stereotypes. So we have the problem in the Black community, and we need to look at ourselves and ask ourselves, why are we supporting these images financially? Why are we the ones that are legitimizing these? You see, let me explain something to you. And I realized this long ago because I went to school for film production, and I from there went into the advertising world. So let me explain something. A long time ago, the advertising world made a decision that they were going to marginalize the intelligentsia of Black people, that they were going to marginalize the smart young Black man and the smart young Black woman, and in place, highlight and depict the rapper, the thug, and through this filter system, make sure that these images of an intelligent Black man never got out there. And they did such a job with it that they even had the Black community regurgitating these things in a sense of the term that Black women use, educated lame. He acts white just because he's educated. So instead of us pushing back on these negative stereotypes, we just went further to emulate them in our communities. When the media cleverly planned behind closed doors to co-opt our images and to pervert them, instead of us rejecting these images, we sought to emulate them. See, So it got to a point where Black women got to be so dysfunctional that they didn't know what a good Black man was. So they picked the hustler and the thug to mate with, and there you've got the proliferation of the baby mama epidemic. Black men copied what they saw from the media and said, I want a Black woman with a fat ass and big titties. Damned if she was smart, intelligent, down for the community. Does she have an ass? We got to take responsibility for what we did. Yes, Seth MacFarlane and Netflix, they're putting out these stereotypes, but who are the ones that fostered these stereotypes? We were not the progenitors of them, but we did foster them when they were put out there by the white supremacist global network. Because we believed what white supremacy was telling us in mainstream media, that the good guy of the community was the pimp, the hustler, the thug. Who I wanted it raw, I wanted it rough. And then you end up pregnant by two or three different baby daddies because you wanted it raw. This is what they implanted in our mindsets. We knew these images were stereotyped. We knew these images weren't good, but we took them and we ran with them. And now when Seth and Netflix comes along to take it to the next level, and that's basically what they're doing with the baby being a drug dealer, we have this temperate response. Oh, that's terrible what they're doing. That's terrible. What do you mean it's terrible? These are the images that when we look in our community, we do see these images. These are not fabricated. I mean, there's no baby selling, you know, there's no baby selling drugs. But that's going to happen. you know, mothers carrying their strollers pushing their strollers with the drugs under their baby. That may be the next thing. Because in our communities, we are not emulating the right people. We're attacking the right people who've got their act together, who are educated. Black men talk about, they come along, they talk about, I want a family. I want a house in the suburbs. I want to be able to raise my family in a safe environment. And Black women come, I don't want to be submissive to you. Do you got a six-figure income? It starts talking this nonsense. Meanwhile, the thug comes along and they have no requirements for a thug. Only that he can rock them in bed. And boom, there you go. She's in love with him. I love him. But honey, he's in prison. But I still love him, daddy. I love him. Peace is misunderstood. Well, he's in prison for murder. Well, he was at the wrong place wrong time, daddy. Tell me if I'm wrong. We are going along with their plan. We have allowed them to manipulate our mindset and manipulate our actions to the point where the things that we do are based on a program. So we become programs. We're just enacting the program. I tell you that in the future, when we have the New World Order, it will not be a coup d'etat. It will not be a military takeover, because they know how to manipulate our mindsets to the point of, we in the future will beg to be enslaved. We in the future will beg to be put in chains. That's how diabolical and crafty their new systems are. We go buy this name brand stuff we don't need. We love the Jordans. We love the Gucci. We idolize the thug. We reject the family unit. We don't want to listen to the ministers who are trying to tell us to do the right things. But when that TV comes on and we see so-and-so got the gold chains and he's riding around in nice cars, even though he can't afford it, we go for those images. Why is Nicki Minaj so popular? We know that white supremacy created her. We know that she is an avatar. She is an archetype crafted in the backdoor think tanks and brainstorm rooms of white supremacists, TV stations, movie companies, music industry. Sexy Red, Megan Thee Stallion, all created by white supremacy. These people are not talented in any way, shape, or form. What they produce is garbage. Absolute garbage. Nicki Minaj is talking about her pussy's wet. Are you serious? That's not art. That's not music. That is befitting of people who were once king and queens. Our value system is screwed up. We go out there and we complain every time there's an Egyptian movie made, the gods of Egypt, the Ten Commandments. But do you practice the ancient Egypt or Kemetic spiritual system? No, you don't. You run to the Christian churches. Your mind is screwed up. You don't support the Egyptian sciences. You don't. Oh, you'll run along to, maybe the best thing you'll probably do is become a Muslim with the Nation of Islam because it looks cool. They get to wear these nice suits and bow tie. Again, you're falling for images. That's all you're about, is image. There's no substance to what you're doing. And the white supremacists know it. They see it. They know that all they have to do is craft an image and a good orator, and boy, they got us. They got us. I wrote a book years ago and was in the street trying to give the book away because I was tracing the mind control system of the ruling elite, and I could not give that book away. I was giving it away for free, and black men were so suspicious. When I would say, hey, brother, this is a book I wrote. It's on the mass media propaganda system, how it works. It's yours, free. Oh, nah, man, nah. Like I was holding kryptonite or something. But you go up there and you say, hey, man, this is my mixtape. This is my tape. They'll take it. They'll be like, okay, yeah, man, I'm going to support an artist. And that's a good point, hon. Rapping about abortion, you see, that tells you that there is an intelligence behind what's being put out there. That tells you that there's a sinister plan and an agenda when you have a rapper talking about abortion. Which we know in the black community is out of control. We We abort more black babies or more babies than any other racial demographic. And we talk about these things and they're pushed to the side. We don't care. We don't care. Unless it has a rap track under it, then we care. Put out those statistics and then have, you know, a rap song in the background and watch, we'll be like paying attention then. We've become evil-minded towards our own selves. We have not safeguarded our images. Oh, we talk about being kings and queens, but then we go back to purchasing these sexy red stuff, gorilla stuff, Megan Thee Stallion stuff. That's who we're purchasing. These people are crafted by white supremacists. They are not real artists. They were picked and tailor-made to destroy us. I'm telling you the truth. They are no good. How can you support a woman who said that she drugged men and robbed them? Then when I forgot his name, he's a black astronomer. He looked at this woman's t-shirt and pointed out that there was a planet missing on her t-shirts. Then all of a sudden people are calling him, saying that he sexually harassed a woman. When every day in these rap tracks, we hear them calling women all kinds of names, bitches, hoes. But are we going after them rappers for that? No, not at all. Because you're programmed. You are a program. That's all you are at this point, because you have not purged the virus that's in you. And as long as that virus is in you, it's going to cause havoc and destruction. You're not operating on a God level. You are satanic. And the sad part is, you don't realize that you are programmed. You don't realize that the way that you act in your daily life is according to the program that the master developers wrote, the ruling elite. And the program is killing you, because the program is teaching you to act in ways that are detrimental to any life-affirming actions that you may think about. This is why you have in Chicago black people killing each other. That's the program. They are programmed to have to disrespect one another, to hate one another, to have low self-esteem, to have a color complex. This is all part of a program. The music has subliminal lyrics in it that when you listen to it, is not only satanic, but it teaches you to hate your own brothers and sisters. No one is attacking the white supremacists. You see, you have these black feminists, these women who are going after black men saying, you're the cause of my problems. You're oppressing me. You're part of the patriarchy. Even though black men have never had any power to oppress anyone, why aren't you going after the white oligarchy, the white men who really put the patriarchy in place? Why aren't you going after them for raping you, Why aren't you going after them? For forcing you to have mixed babies and never giving you any part of their legacy, of their wealth, so you can take care of those babies. Why aren't you going after them? Those people in Chicago, you're fighting with each other. Why don't you fight the real powers that be, the ones that are keeping you from getting jobs, keeping you from getting adequate health care? So when you look at this image of good times and these stereotypes, you have to ask yourself, what have I done in return to support these images that will give the idea to Seth MacFarlane and Netflix that it's okay to come out with a show like this? Because somehow or another, they got it in their mindset that if they produced a show, Black people would do nothing about it. That's how they think. Oh, it's okay. We can produce this show. Black people aren't going to really amount to any type of defense. They're not going to really push back on it. There'll be pockets of resistance, but there'll be no real resistance. I'll still have a job. I'll still have my Beverly Hills mansion with my beautiful white girls and my cocaine being delivered to me. You don't understand what it takes to fight these people. Power respects power. The minute you form a resistance that is strong enough so that when you push back, someone loses a job or a show is canceled. The minute you do that, that's the minute that they start to respect you, and they're going to be very cautious about the next time they put out a show. But if you just have these little bouts of complaining here, there, and everywhere, and you're not a cohesive fighting force, you're nothing. You're nothing to them then. You pose no threat. And right now, we pose no threat. You think Hollywood is going to stop making movies about Egyptians looking white? No, because we don't really do anything about it. I mean, we complain here and there, but inevitably no one loses a job. No movie or TV show is canceled. Without that, then your movement means nothing. It means nothing. When you say something anti-Semitic, people lose jobs. People lose careers. Money is lost because they don't play. In fact, we do the exact opposite. We co-opt the image and try to emulate it. We have done nothing since the bus boycotts to push back in a significant way to where the white oligarchy has lost money, or there has been a real penalty for something they've done wrong to us. And that's a shame. And that's what we have to think in terms of. The lion's teeth, the tiger's teeth. When we sink our teeth into them and we draw blood, that's the moment that they're going to get scared. And they'll realize that they're in trouble. But otherwise, us writing these little articles about how, you know, we don't like good times, about how it's stereotypical, we'll stop supporting the images then and work together to get somebody fired. Whether it be Seth or lower the subscription to Netflix. Make it so that people are no longer going to be watching Netflix. Then, and only then, will they respect us and they stop with the stereotypes. So I want all of you, if you appreciated this message, to donate to this channel. It helps for me to make more videos. You see, every other group out there respects their religion, respects their preachers. We don't. We are the only people who support the ones that have enslaved us. Christianity was used to enslave us. The Native Americans and us were forced to accept Jesus, or we would be burned at the stake or hanged. And what do we do in return? We open up a Christian church. Oh my goodness. What do we do in return? We start a Christian church. And not only that, we put up a picture of the white Jesus. Oh my Lord. We put up the poster of the white Jesus. And then when our elders come to us and say, hey, you know, you were the original Kemetic people, that the Egyptians were black, you go, okay, that's kind of cool, and then go right back to the Christian church. My God. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. You understand what I'm saying? That's how backwards we are. That's how the white supremacist system knows they can get away with all this stuff, because we have not pushed back in a very significant way. In a very meaningful way, in a very threatening way. I remember once they brought me into this room at this job I was working at years ago, sat me down and told me today would be my last day, that they're going to let me go. And they just stopped and paused. It was three of them waiting to hear my response. So I said, oh, that's cool. So I just want to make sure I understood what you just said so I can tell my attorney when I filed my lawsuit. I had their attention then. Then I had their attention. And what did I do? I actually filed a lawsuit. And I won. And I won. You see, you talking doesn't do anything, but actions, your actions lets them know that you are not to be played with. But we're taught and trained to be passive. We're taught and trained that to be cool, you got to have a thug life. You know, speaking on that, you know the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard of? And I'm going to end it with this. It's to sit here and hear these rappers talk about, you know, I'm from the streets. So when I do business and I'm sitting there with those record executives, I'm bringing my street knowledge. You see, I'm bringing my street knowledge. And they know they got to respect me because I'm from the streets. You're a freaking idiot. You are, I don't have the words for it. You're a dumbass. This white man didn't build an empire from being from the streets, He built an empire for going to Harvard and Yale. and then employing your dumbass at a very low rate because you're uneducated and you're stupid. And you think that you can bring street knowledge into a business environment. And they'll listen to you and they'll laugh at you behind closed doors. They'll laugh at you. Because you're a neophyte. We gotta stop this ignorance. We've gotta stop holding the image of the thug gangster up high and worshiping it and celebrating it. That's not somebody we should be emulating. That image is dangerous and destructive. But they have done that. You see, they have pushed that image into the forefront of the mainstream media and society so much so that you think that's a legitimate way to act. So you emulate it. You think it's the proper way of acting and doing business. It's not. It's not at all. It's foolish. See, I apply my street knowledge, you know, and why are you buying those so-called liquor companies? Because you're too stupid to know how to purchase real stocks and bonds and fiber optic cables and satellites. That's what they're doing. All you know how to do is purchase a liquor company. But the real things that matter to the world and things that if you get involved in them will give you power are the banking institutions, are Wall Street, are technology. But you see these dumb rappers, your Jay-Z's, your 50 Cent, and all they can do is buy a bottle of water and liquor. And they think they're businessman. They're businessman. I'm a businessman. I'm moving. I'm a businessman. I'm a businessman. You're a jackass. You're nobody. But you have been taught by the society that that's all you can ever accomplish and that's all you can ever be. Because you don't think of those things that are outside your purview. You don't think about getting into the oil industry. No, you don't think about that, do you? You don't think about purchasing cell towers. You don't think about buying a fleet of jets. You don't think about investing in laser technology. So when you're a Farrakhan and you say, I'm going to get together a mass group of black men and we're gonna march on Washington. Okay, so what's the agenda? Are we gonna like buy military weapons, invest in tanks, fiber optics, invest in satellites? What are we gonna do? We're going to pray when we get there and atone for our past sins. Excuse me? You mean we're gonna do nothing? No, brother, I said we're gonna pray and atone for our past sins. Meanwhile, the white oligarchy is having secret meetings on islands that you can't come to, where on these islands, they're dividing up the planet and talking about who's going to have what on the planet. Okay, George Soros, we're going to give you parts of Africa, and you're going to have the gold mines, you're going to have the silver mines. okay, Bill Gates, we're going to give you all of the things that relate to the chemical, so you can create chemical warfare, and you can also create the the shots and everything that can infect them with diseases. you know what I'm saying? I can't say too much. That's what they're doing. And everything that you're doing is nothing but Looney Tunes. You represent no threat because you're not intelligent. You're just a program that's operating on autopilot. And the thing is, your program teaches you not to harm them, not to be competitive and get into any industry that they're in, because they don't want any competition. You understand? And hon, you're right. You're right. But your quote on 1,000 points of light, that's absolutely right. They're thinking long term. See, Black people, all we think about is immediate gratification. Just show me the money. Show me the money. People talk about how prolific Tupac is. I pulled up an image today of Tupac and who was it? It was Tupac and Suge Knight. And you see Tupac in the background just counting money. You think Bill Gates and George Soros are standing there counting money? For one thing, they got too much money to be able to count it all. But the point is, people think that Tupac is so prolific and he's ignorant. Tupac was an ignorant person. Come to Def Jam and get paid. Seriously? Is that your plan? Is that your plan to fight global white supremacy? Is that your plan to uplift Africa? Is come to Def Jam and get paid? No, you see, brother, you see, Tupac has some really, really like good lyrics. Oh, okay. So how are those lyrics going to feed our brothers and sisters in Africa who are starving and impoverished? See, King Leopold in the Congo murdered millions of Africans there. So those lyrics of Tupac's, how are they going to make restitution for that? You tell me. Tell me. You say Tupac's so prolific. You know, Lao Tse and the others wrote, you know, The Art of War, The Book of Changes. These men understood war. Show me where Tupac wrote something on battle strategies, revolutionary strategies. Where's his book on guerrilla warfare? Well, he was just an artist, you know, but he was prolific. But show me where that does anything. Show me where that changes anything. See, you've been programmed to idolize the Oompa Loompas. You know, Oompa Loompa Loompa Dee Day. We don't do anything but just talk and say Oompa Loompa. I'm tired of music. I'm tired of lyrics. I want real world solutions. I want action. Well, brother, we were the first men and women on the planet. We were kings and queens. Oh, that's great. That's great. Show me how that changes the fact that we are getting our ass kicked out there on a daily basis. We're unemployed. You understand? We have a mental illness crisis among us. We're dying each day from black-on-black crime, so-called black-on-black crime. So you show me how that changes that, you know? We're not focusing on the right things. We're not. But if we were to make decisive strikes that would spill blood, then they would realize we mean business. Instead of taking these marches on Washington to come together to do nothing, to do nothing. And everybody was so excited. Yo, when Farrakhan's, he's good, he's powerful, he's this, he ain't nothing. The powerful men, you'll never see them. You'll never see them. They're behind closed doors. Anyway, I want to thank you all for attending. Make sure that you donate to the channel. Your donations would be appreciated. This is Kasank Maa Keperu, son of Maa Ntuli. Maa is the beautiful goddess Seru. Until my next video, Amun Ra.